What is up, Sonic movie fans? Sonic movie 2 fans, actually.
Oh, shit.
To the Sonic movie show, the Sonic movie 2 show, the only show that's about Sonic news, and Sonic movie 2 news, and Sonic movie 2 reviews. My name is Ethan. With me here on this very special day is Devin.
Sonic, meet Knuckles.
There we go. That quote is obviously from Sonic the Hedgehog 2. Is the official title of this movie, but I like calling it Sonic Movie 2. Their own hashtag is Sonic Movie 2, not Sonic
it's
2 Movie.
Well, probably because it's also Sonic shorter to be on Twitter, that if it was Sonic the Hedgehog Movie 2 or whatever, it wasn't so long.
But I mean, like, no one's calling it just Sonic the Hedgehog 2, just in general, like, referring to this movie. Everyone's like, it's the Sonic Movie 2. So, but yeah, we watched this movie. The day of recording is Wednesday the 6th of, I almost said October. April.
What month?
It's still, it's October of 2020. This pandemic won't end. We watched the movie early access. We paid the extra money. God, I haven't even looked at the poster in the comic book. I forgot about that.
I didn't even. They asked if I wanted one. I'm like, I'm good. I'm like, where is this gonna go? I'm gonna probably put this in a box and then forget. You know,
I had to go and pee.
Save it for the kids. Save it for the kids. Because like, there was a kid in front of me who was super excited about it. I'm like, you know what?
This is
for you. Like, this isn't for me. So it's
okay.
Was
like, I took it. Well, so like the AMC I went to, you can't walk in the concessions or the bathroom. You need to get a ticket.
Yeah, same.
Before you even enter. Because my plan was use the restroom and then get the popcorn, because when I saw Uncharted, I did not do that. And I had to pee 30 minutes into the movie. So I made sure not to do that. I had to pee 60 minutes into this movie. So I'm like, oh, yeah, I forgot about that. I'm like, I had the poster folded up with the comic book inside under my arm as I go pee. But then I come back out and, like, yeah, there's, like, a bunch of kids. They each got their poster and their thing. And this dad was trying to tell this kid who wanted the poster in the comic book that they're going to get it on the way out so they don't have to carry it. And he asked this mom and her kid that were in front of me in line, and they were in front of them, if he could have her poster or her comic book, because he was eyeing the comic book. She's like, here you go. Dad's like, no, we're gonna get it afterwards. And it was funny. I haven't even taken a look at what it is. Yeah, but
that reminds me of early, like, screening at a concerts, the people who sometimes buy like the crazy merch, like the vinyls and stuff. And I'm like, okay, you know the show's gonna start, where are you putting that? Like, we're all standing,
right?
Like, I'm like, if you're gonna buy that shit, you gotta get it at the end. Like, it's one thing if you buy a shirt and you put it on, maybe you're gonna sweat through it, whatever, but I always thought that was funny. Same concept where I'm like, I thought the same thing as well, where I'm like, okay, if I did want this, where am I gonna put it?
yeah
it's not like the Pokemon trading cards we got at
Detective Pikachu. I still have from the third Pokemon movie, because, you know, everyone got it, so whoever took me to see that movie also got it, and they gave it to me. I still have, like, the Entei trading card or whatever it was, like, in, like, the plastic sleeve thing around in some box. We saw the movie early, blah, 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 blah. Did you have any trailers? The first, like, half of the time that was dedicated to trailers was just the follow us on Snapchat thing or whatever it was.
I didn't have that at all. But I also got there, like, because my movie started, like, it tells me to get there at 6, right? Movie really, really doesn't start till 6:20. So I got there at, like, I walked in, I went to the bathroom, I sat down, I think, at, like, 6:05, maybe 6:08, you know what I mean? So if it was there, maybe it was before.
It was just
random trailers that I've seen the last couple months. Like, you know, I had the DC.
Some of my trailers for movies that were already out. I had the Harry Potter one. Like,
yeah,
that movie's out.
Yeah.
Weird. Must not
By
be
way,
a lot of
this movie, I hope, is the Harry
Potter,
killer. Harry Potter killer.
Fuck yeah. Oh my God. Like, it's just so topical. I promise we'll get to the review in a second, guys. Seeing that trailer and then it just said from J.K. Rowling in big text, I'm like, that's like saying this was from Hitler. Like, that's just poison. Your name should not be on there. I get it. She's, you know, oblivious to the fact that she's awful, but, like,
she knows. She's awful.
Woof.
You know,
let's
who
just hop
awful?
Into
Sonic.
It.
Sonic.
By
the way, this is non-spoilers. Non-spoilers for the first.
I was going to say that. Yes, we'll tell you when we're actually going to talk spoilers, but we're going to start by giving our thoughts in a non-spoiler way, you know, using information from the trailers. So I guess if you went complete blackout, you are not even listening to this then, if you didn't watch the trailer.
Yeah.
So you don't care about our opinions if you didn't watch any of the trailers. But Yeah, I will just begin. I will say that this movie, in many ways, was stuff I did not expect and stuff I did expect, but in slightly different, you know, ways than we had predicted on the previous episodes of this show. Overall, I think it was fantastic. There were a few moments where I'm like, this could get cut, not necessarily replaced. You could just cut this scene, this part, whatever, and just make the movie even shorter, and I would be okay with that. Obviously, I would like, you know, a 4-hour movie of just Sonic running around through the levels of the video game with this, you know, like, but like, that's not, you know, like, so there are scenes where I'm like, you know, this could have gone away, or like, you know, screen time given to X side character could be given to Y side character instead, in my opinion. But like, all those are just like afterthoughts of just like how much I loved this movie. This is me trying to make sure I'm not just 100% glowing about this movie without having any sort of criticism. You know what I mean? That's where my criticisms come from, is making sure I'm not just being a fanboy about this movie. Because, and this is my final point about this before I hand it off to you. You know, I've seen all the Marvel shit. Cool. I like Spider-Man. The Iron Man movies made me like Iron Man. The Marvel movies made me like most of these people. I didn't even really know who Captain America was, whatever. I pop off for the parts in the movies. Yay. I see the teasers. I'm like, cool. There's a purple guy who's going to beat them all up. Neat. Google, who is Thanos? Cool. I was never one of these people that like knew what the fuck was going on, or knew what was next, or knew what movie this was based off of. The closest it'll ever be for me with Marvel is that I read like most of the Thor comics where it's Jane Foster, which is what the next Thor movie is like somewhat about. So I'm like, oh cool, I know somewhat about maybe what they're doing. Other than that, I don't give a fuck. I learned who Igor the Living Planet is, or whatever the fuck it is, when I saw the movie for Guardians 2. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. I'm not one of these people. I enjoyed them. I now get it. Because when I see stuff in this movie, I'm like, holy shit. When I see like potential things in the future, I'm like, I know exactly what they will be basing this off of, type of stuff. You know what I mean? If they, well, they already did announce a third movie, and we'll give our predictions in a future episode. We're not going to do that today. Like, I have actually been, this is probably my favorite Marvel movie in that sense. Like, oh, okay, this is based off of something. And like, I, you know, I get to have all this stuff that I didn't have with any of the Marvel stuff, like maybe Spider-Man, but like, I don't really care all that much. I loved this movie a lot. What about you?
So yeah, and you saw it a couple hours ago before this recording. I literally got back.
Oh man, the urge to spoil stuff for you.
Yeah, I just got back 30 minutes ago, walking out of the theater. My overall thoughts are, I had a really fun time with this movie, and hearing an audience, and since we did early access, I think a lot of the real OG, like real deal Sonic fans showed up. For there was some kids there, but obviously they like,
there
they
was
like
a baby Sonic in my audience.
But there was like grown-ass men here. Yeah. You know what I mean? But I could just tell, you know what I mean, like, it's like a nerd check, you know, you when you see a nerd, you know what I mean, because you're one yourself. So like, there was that kind of crowd, and like hearing them and, you know, seeing that, I think made it more fun for me, like making that a good fun movie experience, as if I watched this at home, maybe I don't know if I would have enjoyed it as much. Not saying I didn't enjoy it, but seeing it in a theater with other Sonic fans, I think is something that we also should be grateful for in a pandemic, because there's could have been a chance that this movie might have been a straight to Paramount Plus or something like that.
Or such a bomb, and it might, but I don't think it will be.
No.
Due to the timing. It could have been released earlier and been such a bomb that there is no third movie, you know? They greenlit a third movie before this movie even got any money. So, like, we're thankful. I'm thankful for that.
But, yeah, there's kind of like what you're saying there. I feel like some scenes could have either been maybe redone or cut completely. There were some jokes I feel like fell flat a little bit, kind of similar to the first movie, but I feel like some of those jokes were also not directed to me. They're directed more for kids. I would say this movie felt more oriented towards kids than the first one, surprisingly. In terms of just, like I said, the humor and like some of the moments, it felt like a cartoon in terms of like how things happen. I'm just like, oh, that's something I feel like I would see in SpongeBob. Like, just whatever.
Yeah.
But I did really like, I think they upped the ante with, I would say most of the visuals, like all the characters, the digital characters look amazing.
Sonic looks a lot better in this movie than he did in the first movie, and I didn't think he looked bad either.
No.
But he looks better. Like the color grading obviously was different in the trailers, people noticed, but like it's also just different from the first movie. This movie's more colorful than that first movie was.
Yeah. They had a great color palette. There was some parts where I'm like, hey, I'm kind of glad they let that happen a little bit. But like you said, kind of like, but I wish they showed a little bit more of this character, or that character, maybe, did this more with the plot. But overall, like, this is a really, really solid video game movie. I think it's better than the first one, but I'm not going to, I won't say, I'm going to say it's like astoundingly better. Like, I'm like, oh my God, this is a level up. Like, I would just say like, this is better than the first one, but I'm not like so blown away by it that I'm like, oh my, best video game movie of all time. This, I don't know how they're going to top this. Like, I'm like, I think they can keep building off of this. And
I think they can easily top this movie.
I just don't. Yeah. So like, for me, it's like, I'm glad this movie exists. I think it's really solid. One of the better video game movies we've reviewed on this show, for sure. Definitely one of the better ones in the last, if not the best one, probably in the last couple of years, maybe outside Detective Pikachu. I know we kind of talked about that one in the past. But I feel like they can keep building off this. And I will say, like, I guess they met my expectations, but they didn't exceed them. And I was kind of hoping they would exceed them. I mean, I think we all cheer for something to exceed our expectations. But they kind of met my expectations, and I'm excited for the future, I guess, based off all the things. Yeah.
Just to piggyback off something you said, I do think this movie is markedly better than the first one. And I'd say the easiest way to see that is just because there's more Sonic-y stuff, like in what he's doing, and you know, obviously there's more Sonic-y characters and what they can all do. The first movie was a good way to describe the movie is Tom and Sonic sit in a truck and then go to a bar and then climb a building and then the climax happens, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Right, this one doesn't necessarily feel like that, obviously.
I'll say there's one disappointing thing is I still felt like this movie had pacing issues, though, because I feel like
yes,
they were trying to up the ante a little bit from the first one, where it was a lot more safer, yeah, which is fine for what that movie was, but like that was kind of our expectations. That's my one thing I feel like they kind of dropped, was there were some pacing issues, and I think that goes back to what you were saying with like some scenes could have either been cut or rearranged. There were some moments where I'm like, whoa, okay, we're here, that's fine, I'm like we're back here. But I feel like we kind of like left something going on at the other place, you know?
Yeah. And like, I mean, I think as a fun family, action movie, I would say this is a 9 out of 10 at the very least.
Oh, yeah.
As far as storytelling goes, it does try to have some sort of theme or message, some sort of growth for one of our main characters, maybe two, really. And they feel like they're just there to make sure that they do have something. They're not explored all that much. And when an aspect of one of them comes around, I'm like, oh, yeah, I forgot that this was kind of what the movie was trying to say about one of its characters. Okay. You know, but I will say performance wise, 10 out of 10 for everyone in terms of was not disappointed. Jim Carrey was very good doing it. Makes me almost sad that this might be his last movie. I feel like, though, before you give your opinion on that, I feel like he would be the type of guy that would see what I imagine to be lots of positive feedback from kids seeing this movie, saying they liked him in this movie, that might make him at least want to do more of these. You know what I mean? And no
record,
spoilers,
folks,
about his fate or anything in this movie,
yeah,
but like,
he did an interview recently where he said, like, I might, like, he's kind of getting the age where he's like, you know what? He's done so much different shit that he's probably like, I feel like, you know, he's done the all.
I feel like I've done it all.
Like, because he's on TV, he's done like small TV shows, he's done these big blockbusters, he's done comedies, he's done
serious
dramas.
Things.
Yeah, so like, I feel like he's, you know, so. But yeah, I hope so too, because I think
yeah.
And it also makes it crazy for me if this is his last one. I always think about, like, I grew up watching Jim Carrey. So, like, if it's kind of funny that we do a movie podcast.
And now you will die watching Jim Carrey.
And then, like, he's, like, this could be it. But,
yeah. Yeah, and I mean, like, I would be disappointed just because, you know, Eggman is in all of the games. Even when we're talking about, like, a game like Sonic Adventure 2, which is kind of billed as Sonic versus Shadow, Eggman is still in it. It's his ultimate plot. He needs to be stopped at the end. Like, he's in all of them. Like, it's not like, you know, Mario doesn't fight Bowser every single time. You know what I mean? But, like, so you could, I could see how a third Mario movie might replace Bowser with another popular Mario villain. But Eggman is in all of them. Yeah. Like, that dynamic that needs to be there. And they wouldn't replace Jim Carrey. They would just not have him in it. And they'd have the plot focus on some other thing. You know what I mean? For the story.
Sonic goes to college.
Yep. Yeah. I'm just no kid no longer.
Like, he's like, I have feelings for girls now.
I can't wake up early enough.
He got too wasted at a party. First time he gets drunk. And then he goes to the hospital. And. Yeah. Tom has to go.
No responsibility for the money he earns from his part-time job there. He spends it all
on weed.
And what am I going to eat? My plan is up or whatever. It sounds like we both very much liked this movie. Is there anything you want to impart to the audience in a spoiler-free manner before we dive into the spoiler zone?
If you haven't seen a movie at a theater since the pandemic started, one, I don't blame you. First, I'll say I don't blame you. I personally just still masking up when I go to any of these kind of things. Yeah. But if you're a big Sonic fan and you're like, oh, I still, you know, I'm excited for this movie, but maybe I want to wait for DVD. But if you feel that you can be safe enough, maybe you have some friends who are into Sonic or whatnot, go see this movie in theaters. You'll enjoy it. You'll have fun. You'll be talking about it afterwards when you go to Buffalo Wild Wings or whatever the fuck. You know what I mean? I don't know. I just feel like if you really like this movie, go support it. I'm not saying to go see it 10 times. I mean, if you want to, go ahead. Cool. But, like, I think we should, you know, if you really are, like, hyped for this movie, go see it in theaters. You won't be disappointed.
Yeah. If there were a movie you feel like you know, this movie already has a third movie greenlit. It would, like, TV show could get canceled, though, and the third movie could get canceled, though. If this movie bombs, yeah, they will change their mind on things.
Money
the TV
talks,
show
yeah.
could be a special or a two-parter. They could call, you know, like, they can do whatever they need to do. The third movie could be straight to Paramount Plus. You know what I mean? Or what, I think that's what it's called, right?
Yeah, Paramount Plus.
Their streaming thing. Like, you know, Marvel, Disney will always make all of their shit. You know, all these major things, they will continue to make their stuff. This, you know, that first movie was made in such a fashion that it could be a standalone, and they were expecting that. Let's be real. They had hopes, but we watched the
director's commentary version of it. You could, Jeff Fowler literally say, like, oh, we have this in here in case we ever get
in
the chance
case.
To make a second one. They had no idea that the movie was going to be as successful as it was.
Exactly. So, like, this one, the marketing, I mean, there's been so many different tiny TV spots and
Super
sequences shown in just on YouTube. I've seen so many different clips, official clips. Like, the marketing is going crazy. They want to make sure that most of the best jokes in the movie are in trailers, maybe not necessarily shown in the proper scenes. They're ADR'd on random different scenes.
Yeah.
But they need to people to know that this is a funny movie. Please watch this movie. And they're doing stuff in such a way with this marketing where it feels like you can't escape this movie. Obviously, we are too dialed in to avoid this movie. Yeah. So, like, sure, take our perception perspective with a grain of salt here. But, like, this movie feels like it is huge already. We saw early access. Wow, was this fucking Steam? We saw
we watched the beta version.
Yeah, exactly. We greenlit it on Steam Greenlight. Is that still a thing? Who knows? And they did some really dumb interview thing with Idris Elba and Ben Schwartz that there was a kid in the audience that was like, just show the movie.
Someone's
kid literally said that. Yeah.
Hey, it's Ben Schwartz.
He was upset whenever there was a trailer. He was like, another one. this little kid. That was dumb. But then, like, they do another part that's basically saying, thank you for seeing this in a theater. The fans, like, you are the reason why we keep making these movies. This is amazing. To me, that kind of seems like they're taking this movie, like, especially the people in this movie, are taking it as a, like, hey, this, we probably won't be able to have something this special in production and how we go about making this again. Like, Sonic, people joke about it, Sonic the Hedgehog movie was a lot of people's last movie in theaters before the pandemic, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And for many people, this is around the time where lots of people are going back to theaters. Obviously, I don't know that for a fact. So it feels like the first movie after the pandemic for us was Fast and Furious 9. I probably, if we didn't care, I wouldn't have seen that. Black Widow, maybe not. And then it was like a couple of movies for the show. I saw the Batman,
and it was Full House.
And I still haven't even seen the Batman yet.
And we saw that, like, the Monday after the opening weekend. And I was like, oh, yeah. That'll be a good gauge of, like, how hyped this movie is. Like, how much people give a shit.
And for children, this is easily, most likely, the first movie a lot of movie-going families would go to back. So it has an interesting position it's in, this film.
It's only competitor that is it will Harry never Potter get again. There. I'm not even. I know we joked about it at the beginning, but its only competition I would say is that. And that movie. And
that's a movie
is
that's
a
not
weird
colorful
marketing.
And no fun.
And it's not marketed, I feel like, in a way that is supposed to be for the family, but isn't.
It looks like it's just for Harry Potter fans at this point. If you care about the lore, yay. Fuck J.K. Rowling. Fuck Joanne.
Sonic says trans rights.
Goddamn right he does.
that would have been great if they opened the movie with that, by the way.
I mean, what? Sonic's blue, or Knuckles is red. You get someone that's beige to be in the middle, and you have the flag there.
Yeah.
Okay, let's spoil this movie. Last chance, folks. Get the fuck out.
One last thing.
If you don't want to see this.
One last thing, though. Sorry, one last thing. I will say, you're talking about the trailer's beginning. My start of the movie was like super abrupt because it was showing the whole like DC, you know, where we need heroes for 2022 like thing that
I didn't see that one at all.
Oh, it's like they show the Batman, Aquaman, the Flash, lol, and whoever the fuck four are in Black Adam so they show like those four movies, like they're doing like a weird like merge trailer, be like, you know, it's for the heroes of 2022, and then it like did a hard cut to like the opening Paramount.
Really?
There was no like, huh. It went to black, and we had the lady before that too. The what's her name going to be like AMC? We make movies better. We had her, and then the DC thing, and all of a sudden it was like Paramount, and I'm like, oh,
that
shit.
Seems like that was a sequence error.
Yeah,
I didn't have DC. Your Twitter picture showed the Spider-Man. I didn't have Spider-Man.
That's when I walked in. It was around Spider-Man was like really? Just starting. Yeah,
the must Spider-Verse have had different trailers. Well, it's great because we had this kid that was like, just show the movie, another one. The trailer. And then it went to, the AMC, the waves and all that stuff, you know, the lights.
We make movies better.
Report people that aren't paying. Fuck, I don't care. and then it was like, okay, now we're starting.
Yeah.
And then just the Dolby Vision stuff.
10 seconds.
And just the Dolby Vision stuff.
I mean, we got no Dolby Vision. We got no Dolby
Vision.
And
then the movie started. Our movie started properly.
Yeah, I think it was someone got lazy. Okay. But hey, whatever.
Hey, it's the one showing each of these theaters are doing. It's not setting it up for the
future. We know it's in beta. We know it's in beta. It's early access.
Movie, it's like a Call of Duty beta where it's like, you're not actually fixing anything. You're just trying to stress test your servers. That's it. Don't call it a beta. Gabe comes out in a month. You're printing the discs. Don't call it a beta. let's take this beta into Sigma male mode. Spoil this movie. Let's stop footsing around the bush here. Is that a term? This movie was great. I don't know where I want to start with this. I don't know if you have any particular spot you want to start with. I will just say my theater was packed. So while there was, you know, laughs and not necessarily cheers, but like, you know, people being happy with what's going on, various amusement murmurs and whatever. The only real pop off was huge. And it was my boy, spoilers, Shadow the Hedgehog in the post-credit scene popping up there.
Coming out
everyone
of a,
was
a,
like,
a
oh
test
my
tube,
God.
Like Mewtwo or some shit.
Yeah. They are kids that probably only know him from Sonic Forces or in like the internet. Being like, oh my God. And then there's like people next to me being like, dude, I played Shadow the Hedgehog on my GameCube. And I'm like, that game sucked. But yeah, I was right there with you. It was rated E10 because he says damn when he falls down a pit and dies. That was the huge pop off. And it made me so fucking happy.
Yeah, people were whooping and hollering at mine. There was one kid who, or a guy, I don't know. He was just very excited throughout the film. He did talk a little bit too loud sometimes, but I was like, whatever, okay. You're enjoying it. That's cool.
This is a special event type of
a
thing.
So I'm like, you know what? I respect it. Like, and he's like, that Shadow. Oh, that Shadow. And I'm like, yes, it is, dog. I'm so happy for you.
Goddamn right. It's my Breaking Bad clip. You're goddamn right.
It'd be fun. Okay, like we were talking about, like, what if Knuckles, that his scene there was... It's him getting on the test tube. He grabs a gun. He's like, time to pop off a bitch or something. Like, he just drops a bomb. Because what's this movie, PG? Like, we'll make it PG-13 just for the end credit scenes where he drops an F-bomb or something.
This movie, in like the first like 15, 20 minutes, has a lot of instances where a character says something like, holy shit, holy fuck, but they say a different word. And it's
Eggman
all in
was
the beginning.
First one. Eggman's
holy
the first
shiitake.
One.
And there was like... There was just a bunch. I'm like,
I think Tom
says
something at some point too, where he's like, I think he yells at Sonic for doing something or whatever. And
There's just a bunch in the beginning. I'm like, huh? What if this is like the funny angle? They're like, fuck it, we have your money already. You know what I mean? We're just gonna see what we can get away with, and then it gets toned down. I just to go on the Shadow thing a bit. I don't want to necessarily predict the next movie in this episode. We'll save that for a future one. But I don't think it's a... I think it was calculated that they did it in such a way where he doesn't have to speak. My reasoning is Sonic movie 1, again, not expecting to make a sequel. Here's what we're kind of pointing at in the future. Post-credit reveals Tails. Tails says a line that they put in every single trailer for this movie because they redid that scene for this movie. And, you know, they're not going to try to find an actor to be Tails in case they maybe do another one. You're going to hire a celebrity to do one line and that's it. So, of course, you get Tails' voice actress, right? Easy. Makes sense. No one's going to complain about that. And then there's an obligation, regardless of if they wanted her to be in the next movie or not, but there's an obligation to make her Tails in the next movie. I think they want to avoid that with Shadow and not have the guy that voices Shadow be in the post credits and just have him sit in that tube. You know what I mean? We're already get popping off anyway. Like, revealing Shadow is almost a bigger deal to Sonic fans than revealing Tails, because Tails is a given for a sequel. Shadow, you know what I mean? That was our, you know, safe prediction. You want to do something that isn't just this movie again with the Emeralds. You put Shadow in the mix. That's just my theory. Also, could just be the direction they wanted to go with anyway. But that's a theory.
I wish they're like, and they're like, we've been doing an experiment since 1950, and everyone's like, oh, it's gonna be fucking shit. And like, and they do like, they'll show like more visual.
They
hints
show
that...
his shoes, but it's just her wearing the shoes. Yeah, you know what I mean. They did the pan up,
and she's fucking hot. Like, she's like the hottest. Like, they just make her like way too sexualized. Like, that would have been...
That's a character that they would most likely give a redesign to.
Oh, I
it might
hope
be
so.
Subtle.
I hope so,
but. Yeah,
I'm obviously joking, but I think it would have been hilarious if, like, you, like, hint as if it's Shadow for, like, 45 seconds, and then all of a sudden they're like, nah.
It's Big the Cat.
Yeah, it's just, like, not what, like, this is what you wanted, right?
Yeah. So that, honest to God, and that's a cheap thing to say, because post-credit scenes for a lot of stuff are always meant to be the obvious last thing you see, and they're the most hype, because they're trying to hype you up to buy a ticket for a future movie. And tell your friends to go see this one. You know, the best post-credit scene of all time is Fast and Furious 6. This feels up there for me because I understand what the fuck that they're doing as opposed to a Marvel thing. So it's cheap to say that that's my favorite part of the movie. But since I brought up something, what was your favorite part of this movie?
So this is, it's weird. Like, it's a favorite part for me, but also a disappointment. I'll explain why. Is because when we watched all the trailers, we did an episode, I think, 2 weeks ago, where we were kind of like trying to, you know, kind of guess what's really going to happen in this film. And we were worried that, like, okay, this trailer is showing everything. This trailer is showing all the set pieces. And for the most part, it did. So that's my one disappointment. And that's one of the things I had, I think I knock it down a little bit for, is that I'm just kind of sick of these movies showing everything in a trailer and not keeping me surprised that they go to this location or fight this character or this twist happens. I did still like the robot, though. I think they did such a good job with the robot, and they make it so cartoony, and they let Jim Carrey just do his thing in there, and they did like here's a big CGI screen or whatever, like, do whatever, just, and they let him, I feel like they let him do his thing, generally speaking, and then they animated around that.
Right. Yeah.
That's what it felt like, and I feel like that it was just such a great job. So at least. Well, I'm disappointed that, like, the set pieces were all kind of what we generally guessed. Maybe we didn't get them in the exact order, but we generally speaking, we were like, okay, this is probably going to be the end of the movie. They're all going to team up. But it wasn't exactly how I expected it to be, and it was a lot more funnier, and it was just cool. So I was like, at least, I'll let it – it won't be that big of a deal for me that, we kind of predicted this, but at least the battle was cool. Like, the robot had a lot more random – weapons than I was expecting to. It wasn't just a big brute thing.
Barrage of missiles.
It was lasers. It was
more than that.
Had the mustache attack, which I thought was great. I think that whole kind of ending was kind of cool.
The robot is great too to have as the final thing for this movie, because that's the final boss in Sonic 2, right? With the one, Tails and all that. I feel like the way obviously the robot was designed to look like Eggman, just like the original giant robot at the end of Sonic 2, the game was, which, it looks like Eggman, the video game character, and not Jim Carrey's Eggman Robotnik. And I feel like that was deliberate in a way of like, hey, we're going to do a couple nods to that. We're not going to put him in a fat suit. We'll joke about that. No, a half a second slide that pops up on a screen in a cafe. But this is what we'll do for that. And I will say too, Jim Carrey with the kind of when he has the emerald with him, however it was, and it's like electrically amplifying his voice. There's parts, especially when he's in the robot, where he kind of does sound like Eggman's voice actor in a sense. Like, they do, you've heard, Eggman speak in the games. Yeah. It's still Jim Carrey, but the way they've electrically amplified his voice or whatever for when this post-process or whatever it does remind me actually a bit of the game character Eggman. I'm like, I don't know if that was intentional or not, but I liked that.
I think Jim Carrey also knows, that's how he kind of sounds. But he's also trying to do his own thing. But, I know at the end of the first one, remember, he kind of was doing that similar voice as well, just obviously not electrified. And there was moments throughout this movie where I feel like I'm like, oh, that's, I feel like a nod to Eggman's voice actor, 100%. I said, he's still going to be Jim Carrey because that's what people are – some people got tickets for. Or maybe that's why Dad, who doesn't care about Sonic, and his son does, but he's like, you know what? I saw Jim Carrey in the 90s, and that was fun.
Jim Carrey's the biggest part on the poster.
Yeah, so I think he did a good blend of that. Classic Jim Carrey with the Eggman stuff.
I'll say, a character I felt was underutilized was Agent Stone. I don't feel like he does anything in this movie. It's
they keep
sad.
Sleeping on my boy. That's my boy right there. That's he's great.
Agent Stone.
Lee there he is on Twitter as well, and I want to say he was the best dressed at the premiere. I don't know if you saw the premiere.
I saw your two responses to it.
He looking fly. I'm just saying, and it seems like we know he might be in the next one based off the. Maybe Eggman won't be in it, but he'll be in it because remember at the end it showed him undercover.
I forgot about that. Yeah,
I hope he's involved, and I want him to have a bigger. I don't know how, but just figure out a way, because I really do like him. Granted, I think half his character is supposed to, be the dumb guy next to Eggman. But I feel like if there's a way they can get him involved, I was actually hoping throughout this film that he was going to somehow turn into a good guy, because they kind of like left him, or Eggman makes a point being like, we're just going to leave him here because I don't give a fuck.
Yeah. And I wish he didn't even react to that, which is weird.
I wish they maybe like in some way he's like, you know what? F Eggman. I made lattes for him. I've been waiting for him for so long, and he comes back and kind of just dumps me to the curb. I wish there was like maybe that dynamic a little bit.
Yeah.
So they could like that do that with the
third movie, yeah, if
missed opportunity. But
and like Eggman falls to his death in such a way that could easily be explained how he did not die. You know, even like his final words were a goof. You know what I mean? Like, he's not dead unless they can't get Jim Carrey back. Then, well, we'll just not talk about him until maybe we can convince him in the future for a fourth or fifth movie.
And I wonder if like maybe he told him like, hey, this might be my last rodeo. Like,
I mean, if he's not on contract to do multiple films, they got to assume that's a possibility, right? This was probably a one at a time type of deal that they were going with. You know, if they greenlit the third movie a couple weeks ago or whatever, or no, it was like a month or so ago, because they announced the TV show along with
it. It was like late February, early March. Yeah.
Yeah. So then, you know, if they decided then, you know, then, you know, maybe the talks with Jim Carrey, you know, haven't happened yet or something. Who knows? Maybe talks had stopped or whatever. I will say one thing that I didn't dislike about this movie, but it just like, oh, okay. They clearly took from the first movie the few jokes that they know landed the best. The steamed Austrian goat milk, the sister-in-law that hates Tom.
Yeah.
A couple of these jokes, and they're like, cool, that's the jokes in the next movie now. We're just going to make sure that they're back again. And I'm like, eh. It's like, okay. Okay. Like, I did like, you know, she hated Tom and still does. I like that.
I think out of like, all of those reused ones, I think that was the best one.
But the Austrian goat milk, that was just a random aside. That wasn't integral to the relationship and the character. But like, since that landed on Twitter for people, yeah, then they brought that back. I mean, that was the fucking code word to turn the cafe into the lab. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like they amplified that up. I did like, feel free to jump in at any point if you wanted to say something. I did like, there's a lot more game references in this movie than the first one, and more than just poses. The name of the cafe is Mean Bean, just like the Sega Genesis game, Dr. Robotnik's Mean Bean Machine, which is just like, Poyo, yeah, Poyo.
I feel like you would know more of those than me.
Yeah.
I know he did the Sonic Adventure pose.
Yep. Which is great. So a lot of these are fucking escaping my mind. When he falls off the canoe, he's doing the Sonic is drowning idle animation, which might have been in one of the Sonic games, but is definitely what Sonic does in Smash Brothers. If he falls in water, that's his drowning pose. There's just a lot of that stuff.
He sucks the air out of the bubble, which is a lot more direct instead of like, I would say, like a Easter egg was like, nope, this is how he's surviving in this situation. Yeah.
Dude, there's a Labyrinth Zone reference.
Yeah, when he slides down the...
Yeah.
That was I love that one, I think, the most. Because
that didn't seem... Like, Mean Bean, that's words on a thing. People are going to look and be like, oh, yep, that's easy, you know. The helicopter says SA2. That was in a trailer. We already knew that. Oh, like Sonic Adventure 2 opens up with him on a helicopter. The Labyrinth Zone is awesome. So for fans out there that don't exactly know what we're maybe talking about, Knuckles and Robotnik, Eggman, are going through the temple. They're doing stuff. Sonic and Tails, or Sonic gets there late. So he's running through. And when he enters, we see him entering by him sliding down a 45-degree angle water slide into another one that's going in the opposite direction. It's exactly what happens in Labyrinth Zone. And yeah, okay. What's it called? Hydrocity Zone in Sonic 3 has stuff like that.
But none of those are ruins.
Yeah, it was like Labyrinth Zone was this way feels too direct. Like. Yeah. And if it's not specifically Labyrinth Zone they were going after, it was just Sonic stuff in general.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, I saw that, I'm like, this is what I want. You know, I want there to be a mix of the poses that's on the box art. Cool. You know what I mean? Duh. And I want some stuff that's like this, where it's like, some people might not get it, and it makes me smile. You know what I mean? Like,
and if you don't get it, it still looks cool.
Yeah, it was just fun to see. You know what I mean? The only thing that they still did not do in this movie that I'm not necessarily gonna to knock the movie on, but just wish was there, is just play some of the songs from the game. You know, like there's lots of action sequences in this movie that's just set to music, some popular 40s music, or not 1940s, top 40s type of stuff.
1940s music was in this.
We're still fighting the Nazis. You know, like instead of a random song that plays when the bank or the car heist thing at the beginning in Seattle, why don't you just play a fun remix of, I don't know, Chemical Plant Zone or something? Like, I don't think it would have hurt to do one of those. You know, it's very easy to commission some Sonic fan to make a dope ass remix or just pay for one that's on Spotify.
I mean, besides Wachowski's ringtone, I don't think there was any music that was really... I mean, if there was, maybe it wasn't...
I was trying to pay attention. I had a thought that when Eggman is in the giant robot at the end, and it's, like, revealed, and he's there, it's playing... He, like, plays with the air guitar or whatever, and it's playing music. I'm, like, I'm trying to pay attention. I'm, like, is this part of an Eggman theme?
Oh, that riff? I'm, that, like, when he don't... plays the guitar? That's a Pantera song.
Okay, yeah, okay, I didn't know that then.
Yeah, it's like a really popular Pantera. But I'm the metalhead, so like I'm the only one who probably would have known that. But like,
I don't know who Pantera is.
Yeah, they're a 80s metal band, like thrash metal.
It's like Panera, but they sell pants. Yeah,
exactly.
Okay, well, then I know for a fact that that wasn't part of it. But I'm like, there were parts where I'm like trying to listen, like, you know, and there's obviously action sounds and people screaming over a music. So I'm like trying to see, was there trying to? I don't think so. I feel like if they did, they would try to make it more overt than trying to make it subtle.
Because I know in the first movie, they did Emerald Zone, right? At the end of the movie, kind of.
That was Green Hill.
Or Green Hill. And it was this, you know, violin orchestra, you know, kind of, like I was hoping for that as well. And it was a lot more like just random songs, like Barracuda still slaps, yes, but like I've heard that in other movies, so I wish
That was in there. Yeah, it's just like I would say weird choices considering that
it felt like Guardians of the Galaxy almost at moments, you know what I mean?
Yeah, with, like, but without like
the big text where it says what location you're in and then there's some music,
right?
Like I don't know if Guardians of the Galaxy was the first one to do this, but it's like one of the more popular ones. I know James Gunn loves to do that and all this
fill
shit.
The screen with text of just here, just name a planet.
Yeah,
you know, because you know we went through an era in films where it was like, you know, Paris, France. It's like, bro, you don't need to write France in there. It's if people don't know Eiffel what Paris Towers. Is, it yeah. doesn't matter that it's in France for these people. You can just say Paris. You can say Seattle. You know what I mean? You could say the Mushroom Planet. I'm pretty sure it said the Mushroom Planet at the beginning.
Yeah.
But I just about the music. Just wanted to say like I'll be one of these people that says it right now. The only consistently good thing in Sonic games is the music. There are millions of remixes on these Sonic songs that Mario does not have, that other popular mascot platformer or video games do not have. Sonic has it. So it feels like underutilized.
Is the Halo 3 menu theme, and they could just reuse that for all the games, and it's perfect, you know.
Yeah, like Sonic has that. Like, okay, yeah, there's some Mega Man, there's some Street Fighter, sure, whatever. But like Sonic has that. That is like an industry almost of remixes and rearrangements for fans.
Genre.
So it feels underutilized. You could have just done that. Like I said, y'all could have just hired some fans that, hey, make a dope-ass remix.
And like I said, maybe they did, but maybe the mixing wasn't good enough to where we could hear it. So maybe next time we see this, that may be something maybe we look out for, try to maybe ignore any dialogue in a scene and be like, is this anything? Is this from this game? You know, like, I don't know. Maybe we missed it. So I want to say that we could have missed it.
Yeah. There's, I mean, like,
I saw in the Dolby theater too. So it's like,
same.
We should have heard it. Like it's usually Dolby is pretty good of playing music or like, you know, mixing in general.
You at least feel the vibrations. I'm waiting for my seat to go. Burr, 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 burr. I'm like waiting for my seat to, you know, rumble my ass like that.
Just do a little bit of that.
And, you know, it's easy on a rewatch of a film where you already know where we're going with the movie to pay attention to certain things instead of trying to follow the plot. So maybe on our rewatch, we will notice these things. Keeping with the theme of disappointing stuff or being a little bit critical on some things before we maybe hop into some cool stuff, I will say the wedding went on way too long. You know, like it made sense that they wanted to make sure that they used these side characters and made sure that they weren't just in for a scene. Got to give them something to do. I appreciate all of that. But when we finally get to the sister-in-law confronting her fake fiance, and she has the gun and she shoots the cake, right after she shoots the cake and she's talking to him, I'm like, this whole scene could have been cut. This felt all of a sudden like we're in a different movie. I don't need to see side character D, side character C, you know what I mean? Find romance again or whatever. Like, I don't need to see that. I feel like she had more character than Maddie did, than maybe even Tom did. And I'm like, that's great for her as the actor that she got all this stuff. But like, did we really need that? All of that? I don't give a fuck about her fiance.
I think it could have been shortened.
Like, they could have just did a thing where, like, after, you know, she shoots the cake and, you know, says, yeah, it is real or whatever. And people liked her in the audience. They were laughing at everything she did. They could have just been a thing where he looks at her or whatever and says, we have a lot to talk about, I think. Or, and, like, there's just something like that. And then we cut.
Make an end
and then at the end, they're there. At the end where we see Maddie and Tom together, the two of them are also there. Cool. You can jump the brain. I get maybe kids can't follow along that well. The kids don't care. The kids would have wanted to see more Tails and Knuckles or whatever instead. And like, I don't necessarily think we could have replaced that scene with something else. I think pacing wise, as you were saying it towards the beginning of this episode, it felt off where it was like we had high energy and then it's like we need to talk. And then we're going to high energy again. It just didn't. We could have cut that. Could cut that whole thing.
Yeah. I think at the very least shortened it. Because I liked kind of like some of it. I feel like you said, it kind of felt like a different movie. Maybe it was a Fowler script somewhere in the vault that maybe he wants to do a rom-com at some point. I will say the one twist that I don't think anyone could have predicted was that they were all the feds.
Oh,
that
yeah.
was actually fucking hilarious. Like, I did like, at least if that was their whole goal, that setup was like, oh, even the husband is in on it as well. And yeah. I love how he pulls out the badge. Like, he's wearing, like, this nice-ass, like, you know, suit, but, like, it's one of those beach weddings, so, you know, he has, like, the nicer, like, he has, like, the more,
nicer colors.
Yeah. But I just like that he has it open, right? Like,
he's ready to arrest someone at any moment.
But then all of a sudden, he, like, this whole time, he somehow fit that badge under there. I just thought that was hilarious. Like,
priest has a taser in the Bible.
Yeah, like, yeah, I thought, like, I really did like that part of the whole wedding where it was like,
and they weren't just the feds, they were gun,
yeah, which was also better.
And when I saw that, I'm like, hold on, we're acknowledging gun. Like, gun was in, I think, Sonic Adventure 2 and Shadow the Hedgehog, and that was it. So I'm thinking, like, hold on, are we gonna get a truck chase? No, they, we're not gonna, they didn't,
yeah,
but like,
what if we get a TV show called Agents of Gun? Like Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., but like,
oh my god. Agent Stone is defected. yeah.
And
no,
I mean, also like that they made him and his like crew just like fucking hot. Like, they're like all ripped and just jacked, and like poor Tom is just getting his ass beat when the volleyball. Like,
his teammates don't even want to play with him, just standing there.
Yeah. I'll say
definitely like a Top Gun reference, right? Yeah, I mean, maybe it's just because I saw the trailer for it movie.
I feel like those scenes refer, like, you know, the parents and whatnot who don't really give a shit about Sonic. And I'm okay with it being in, like, but I think it just needed to be either rearranged or shortened in some way. Or maybe, like you said, like, it doesn't do that ending where, like, they do fall back in love or whatever, or they make up. Maybe that should be at the end of the movie, or, like you said, it's implied, or, like, the gang's all here and you know, something. I feel like they just could have shortened that. But I do think at least the punchline of like, oh, they're all the feds.
That was
at least worth it.
And
that was the biggest surprise. Unexpected than Shadow the Hedgehog.
Yes, yes. I also did like the I have the wrong ring. He goes to throw one of the wedding rings. And said like, that's great. That's great. Because, like, imagine him, you're in his shoes. He needs to go up and not only he interrupted the wedding,
he
needs to
once.
Go up and physically walk up there and say, give me the ring. That granted, dog could have been like, here, sorry, I made a mistake. I want to make sure I don't ruin this any further. Here, take this. This was a prop Sonic gave me or whatever. And then throw the thing and let snow come out. Maybe you don't ruin it right then and there, but like, he punches him. Like, I love that. Like, you're gone now. Like, you're gone. You're out of this family. You walked up and assaulted the husband in his wedding.
And I did like when they first meet that character too. He's immediately like, be like, why the fuck did you like basically leave my wife all tied up and stole her vehicle and then got it totaled?
Yeah. Like, yeah, well, yeah, no, it was Sonic drove her car and he crashes it in front of the San Francisco
why didn't he drive?
Yeah.
I still to this day don't know why he didn't drive. I think it's just because it's funny. But yeah. They never explain it or acknowledge it. They're like, yeah, Sonic's just driving it. Whatever.
Yeah, no, I liked that. I mean, also it kind of works too because that guy gets to remind audiences or introduce audiences of the things that happened in the first movie regarding him and the sister-in-law.
That's,
you know,
true.
So it's
that
just a quick
used, if you didn't see the first movie for some reason, you come into this and a quick,
it's just
quick,
bam bam bam.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, that does sound in abstract very fucked. You know.
Yeah.
I like that stuff, you know, and she was funny in her stuff. Maddie didn't really have much to
do,
which is disappointing.
I think Maddie and Stone, I think, got kind of shafted here. I think they should have gotten more, considering that their roles in the first movies, I feel like they kind of set them up to be more. And I think you're right. I'm glad they pulled other characters that we didn't see. And I get like Knuckles and Tails are going to be the big selling points, but it's just like, I wish Maddie had a little bit more. I get they had her action shot with her sister, you know, where they're kicking some feds' butts, but like, after that, you know, she saved Sonic, but like, that's about it. Like, it kind of felt like her role was about the same as the first movie, if even less.
Yeah. I mean, the theme or the message or the character growth, I don't even know which one I would want to say it is, that the movie's trying to say with Sonic is that, you know, he's a kid. You know, this was kind of in the trailer with them on the boat saying this, but like, you know, you are responsible for other people. And then later when Tails is like unconscious and Sonic all of a sudden is like, I did this. I'm like, oh yeah, that was a thing. They could have used maybe her for some of this stuff. Maybe she doesn't need to do cool action-y stuff, but like they could have utilized her for this D plot of, you know what I mean? That this was so
maybe
set
Maddie,
to the sidelines.
Maybe Maddie could have helped Tails steal the plane that Tails gets.
Something.
Yeah.
Because like, you know, they made a point of Sonic, you know, on the boat saying you're not my dad, you know, at the very end he says that, but like they could have done that somehow. And like, yeah, if you're not utilizing this character for much, have a scene with just the two of them. Do the two of them ever have a scene together but doesn't have Tom in it? No. In either of the two movies, right? No. So like you could utilize some of that, but like let's stop talking about the human characters unless you want to talk about Jim Carrey.
I was gonna say with Jim Carrey, we kind of, I feel like, covered him. I mean, he did his thing. Knuckles was actually a lot better than I expected. I was still a little like, I know Idris Elba was gonna be great, but I wanted to make sure while I was watching I didn't feel like Idris Elba was talking, you know what I mean? Like, as much as it was kind of a meme and whatnot, I'm like, no, he's an actor. His job is to not actually be Idris Elba, it's just to be Knuckles. And I think he actually did a great job of like, kind of forgetting that he's voicing this, and he gave Knuckles his own kind of goofy, almost dumb personality, but like a very, you know, lawful dumb, I would say, though. Like, he had his code that he kept sticking to.
I wouldn't necessarily say dumb. I would just say ignorant.
Yeah, ignorant, know? I think would be the better way.
Because he's not an idiot. You know, he just doesn't know. Like, you know.
But no, I really liked him a lot, and he, at the end of the movie, I feel like he kind of like stole the show a little bit when it came terms of like one-liners, like from terms of like Sonic had all the one-liners throughout this film, and he's usually the one-liner guy, kind of like a Spider-Man or whatever, and like Knuckles, I feel like got a lot more one-liners towards the end of the film, or like was telling the jokes.
Yeah, or just like towards the beginning-ish. When he's stuck on the wall and Robotnik's up on top of the cliff, you know, Knuckles thinks he's being going to be shot or whatever, and he's, oh, these are stairs, and then he walks up, you know what I mean? Like, I like that.
And he keeps breaking everyone's hands. I thought that was a cool little thing that they added, that, like, he just doesn't realize, or, like, he does realize how strong he is, but, like, he thinks that's a sign of respect. Yeah, Knuckles was great, and I did wish he, like, I guess not in terms of acting, but, like, I wish the animation, I wish he glided a little bit more. I feel like he kind of did at moments, but it wasn't explicit.
They felt
enough.
More like just jumps.
Yeah, I wish he did his like Sonic Adventure glide, like when he was chasing him in the car. I wish he was just gliding
instead
behind.
Of running. Have him, like, you know, there's a difference between a glide and a fly, right? Knuckles descends slowly while maintaining a good horizontal speed. Do something like that, even if it's not too long, so that they don't really make it look like he could just fly around. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, just do that now. I don't know why he's able to glide in the games.
Who cares?
He's not a flying squirrel. He doesn't have any webbing between his pits. You know what I mean? So maybe they were like, hey, like, this doesn't make sense, so let's not do this in the movie. And
or maybe they didn't.
And the games
right,
have established that.
Maybe, you know, it could have been that too.
Yeah, it could might have looked just weird, you know, to see that. But the games have also established that Sonic, or not, yes, Sonic, but Tails and Knuckles can run fast. Sonic can run faster, but you know what I mean? They can run fast enough that they can keep a pace with him when he's not trying to go hyper super speed or whatever. You know what I mean? It's like that didn't feel out of the blue. When you see the, literally because it's red and yellow. And I guess I will say this. You know, I gave us credit for this before, even though it was really me that first thought of it. I'm willing to take the credit back because I was wrong. Sonic was not the blue Chaos Emerald. Knuckles is not the red one. I thought that was a brilliant prediction. We kind of convinced ourselves the last time about that. It turns out just all the Chaos Emeralds were in the Master Emerald, which is not how it is in the games, but it made sense for how they wanted to go about it for the sake of these films. As we mentioned, it's a kind of a hard idea to be like, there are seven MacGuffins that are all basically the same, and Sonic needs all of them to do the thing. So what, do we do a movie for each one? Is this just the Green Chaos Emerald? No, it's the Master Emerald, because that's tech tied to Knuckles. He's always protecting it, you know. The Chaos Emeralds in the games, to my knowledge, the idea is the Master Emerald can keep them in check. They're not physically absorbed by it, you know.
Yeah.
But that in this case it is, it's kind of like a housing for them. Cool, I'm fine with this. They all kind of shatter, and they're really tiny in this
really
movie.
Tiny, like you could eat it. Look like they look like fruit snacks or something.
Like they look like ring pops,
not for kids under two.
Yeah, like to put it this way, the way the games show them, the Master Emerald in the movie is the size of a Chaos Emerald in the games. You know what I mean? So to see them scaled down more is like, okay. But I'm okay with that. I'm a bit confused at the end, though. Did they fly away like Dragon Balls, or did Knuckles actually scoop them up? I thought that was just the Emerald, Master Emerald, like shards he scooped up and made whole. But did the Chaos Emeralds go back in there? Where'd they go?
I guess. Yeah, I guess.
Because it looked like they went up in a way. But I don't know if they went down.
And, I don't know. It's magic, know, so crystals. Dog,
we'll figure it out. I was honestly not expecting Super Sonic at all in this movie. I don't know why.
I had a feeling, personally, I didn't say in our predictions episode, more just because I didn't want it to happen. I guess it's another disappointment for me. I feel like it was, once like I saw that, like, okay, they're getting cornered, they have the Master Emerald, I'm like, okay, he's gonna go Super Saiyan, Super Sonic. And he looked cool. And I'm glad people like that. I just never liked the idea of Super Sonic. I just feel like it's a Dragon Ball Z ripoff, personally. And it's just cheesy to me a little bit. Even though Sonic is full of cheese, don't get me wrong, and it's okay to be cheesy. I just feel like it was like a little like whatever. But like it's a kid's movie. It's
if
fine.
I could maybe articulate perhaps why you feel that way, because I felt that it went too much with it. You know, Super Sonic can easily be seen in many of the games where he's in there as he flies and goes really fast. And yeah, could probably fly through the robot and break it and be fine. But like, he just stops without moving.
He's
a gigantic, he becomes a god. And like, that's way too much. Like, scale that way back I felt that that was way too much, because now that means, now I have to think about that for the future movies. That is the win button. And not just like, are we need it to have a chance to beat the bad guys. It's like, we get it and we will win. They even call him Golden God. You know what I mean? You go from Blue Hedgehog to Golden God and you wanted to go back or whatever. And like the fact that he can just materialize whatever he wanted. You know what I mean? It was like, that felt too much. If they wanted to get there, maybe save it for a future movie. Like, with him zipping around and going through the robot, I thought that was fine. But to me, it was just the giant wind-up punch, and Sonic, without even moving, there's no resistance with his body, stops it with one hand. It's like,
he's literally an unstoppable object. Like, he's just like, you just can't, just yeah. nothing
will. And an unstoppable force, too. Like, it's...
I will say, at least another unexpected thing that happened, though, with it, was that he summoned a bunch of chili dogs, and I thought that was actually hilarious.
Right.
So he... Because I thought he was going to be evil for a second or something. Like, he was summoning a big storm that just does a lightning strike, and it's just best chili dog. Like, he just, which makes me think he can just create. I mean, I understand that they said that they say explicitly that the Master Emerald gives you the power to, like, if you think it, it happens kind of thing.
Yeah, that's what I was saying. Like, he can just make whatever he wants happen, it seems like.
Yeah.
That's like, too far.
Yeah. But at least they kind of like made fun of it a little bit with like, oh, he just made a chili dog. Like, you know, he could have made whatever. But there's one character we're forgetting that we haven't talked about yet. And I think, and I will say this character actually like made me, honestly, like I never get emotional usually with movies. Like, I'll get emotional movies, but not ever like over the top where I'm like, you know, my like, eyes are getting watery or anything like that. Usually, unless it's like a very
it happens to me a lot.
With like drama films or like
I just, yeah, I guess I like movies more than you.
Yeah, clearly. But like when Tails and like in Sonic were like talking about like being friends, I don't know why. Like I just feel like, I forget her name every time, but the actor.
Colleen, and she's got a long name that starts with an S, and I'm sorry.
But she does all the voice acting for Tails in the last recent years, if not forever, it feels like. But like, she does such a great job with Tails, and like she added so much emotion behind like her Tails telling his story, and then Tails being like, okay, like, am I your friend? Do you mean it? And then Sonic is like, yeah. And I'm like, I don't know why that got me so emotional more than like I was expecting, but I was just like, damn, they real bros right now. I'm like, I love that. Yeah. That's real shit right there. I don't know why. I don't know why it hit me. Like, I'm like, this is like in every kid's movie. This is there's been a scene just like this. But like her like execution of like the emotion in her voice that she added to Tails with Ben Schwartz's Sonic. Just like, I don't know why. Just like I was getting like mildly teary-eyed, and like I was not expecting that in this movie. It's another unexpected thing that happened where I'm like, oh, I pulled my heartstring a little bit. I'm like, yeah, Tails. And it made me like Tails more, honestly. Like, as a character, like, this movie made me like Tails more. And Knuckles as well. I mean, I already like Knuckles because he's kind of a meme, but, like, Tails, I'm like, Tails seems pretty, like, just a good, solid friend. Just Sonic. And I hope we get more Tails.
That's what I wish we could have gotten more. Like, I wanted to see, like, they showed a couple scenes with Tails viewing Sonic in the flashbacks he talks about. Like, I wanted to see more of that. Not necessarily that, but, like, where is he from? He keeps saying village when he talks about Green Hills. He calls it a village. And he said, like, his village, and people bullied him. But, like, village and gigantic computer monitors aren't two phrases that you would normally associate with one another, especially for creatures that don't wear clothes. You know what I mean? So, like, besides shoes and gloves.
just like Sonic.
Yeah, exactly. Because Sonic Green Hill, in the baby Sonic scenes, that was a village. You know what I mean?
Well, no, I think Tails said planet, and then Knuckles. No. He kept saying village.
Tails said my village. Tails 100% said my village, and he also called called Green Hills, Montana, a village. But who knows? Regardless, I wanted to see more of flashback of Tails. Like, we don't need to see a flashback scene of him getting bullied, but like, show how he got here,
because then we'll get to our video game, that idea that we made for Tails, the Tails standalone video
game. Oh my god,
where he was bullied, but he goes to a Catholic school.
Yeah, it was like a choose your own adventure or something with mini games.
You can
it
go find Bible that episode quizzes. If you think that sounds insane, because it is.
It was dumb. If you get one of the questions wrong, you have to start over, whatever we said.
Yeah,
then there was a do you save the bullies or not? That was like one of the final things, because he's building the ark.
Yeah, he's building the ark.
I hope I'm not too late.
Oh my god.
Yeah, Tails was great. Tails zipping around made sense. I like, it was kind of funny that they were flying way up high in Siberia without their winter clothes on. Like, I get it, y'all are hairy, but like, I like when he was carrying Knuckles and was commenting about how heavy Knuckles was, and Knuckles says he's a million percent muscle or something like that.
I like when,
can I also say,
yeah.
Sorry, you go on.
I was going to say the Tails scene when they're in the car as well. Tails is like, oh, they call me Tails. Can you guess why? And Sonic's like, probably because you have two tails. And he's like, yeah, wow, you're so smart or whatever. I'm just like,
only Sonic the Hedgehog could be that smart.
I love that, Tails
he's got
this
weird parasocial relationship with Sonic.
Yeah, but Sonic had no idea. And like, I just like that Tails
Funny. Now that I think about it, because that was what Sonic had in the first movie to Tom and Maddie before they met.
That's true.
He knew all about them and they didn't know he existed. Tails did the same thing. I wonder if they realized that or not, because that would have been a funny joke. Be like, well, shit, this is what it feels
like. Or Sonic would have been like, that's kind of weird. And then if Tails was like, oh, was it weird when you did it? Like, that would have been... Like that would have been like, wait a minute.
Well, they did the funny joke of Sonic saying, "You mean the shower?" And Tails like, "No, you take bubble baths." And there were people laughing at that joke in the theaters.
That
like,
was good.
That's creepy. Another adultish joke was the sister-in-law saying, asking who the feds was. This person was the fed. Was that person the fed? And so was the masseuse who waxed my you know what fed too. Or
that
whatever?
Was the dirtiest like, joke out of all. Huh. Yeah.
Interesting. Then she even says it's her own daughter, an agent,
which would have been hilarious if she was.
I honestly, that would have been too real, too dark. You know what I mean?
Everyone in her life is a fucking cover up.
It was like, your daughter was a child actor.
It would have never even made sense because like the kid was there when Sonic was first introduced. That like they hired her somewhere down the line. That like she's like.
I mean, if they're going to have our main,
you're going to get your whole life sub. You already got a job with Gunn.
this movie's reoccurring jokes that they brought back from the first one is that the main Gunn dude or whatever still likes Olive Garden and thinks a gift card is a good gift for saving the world or whatever. So yeah, they could easily do that joke of like, hey, do you want to help the federal government? And she's like, yeah.
And you get a $10 Olive Garden gift card. As a kid, that's a lot of money. Yeah.
Foot Locker or whatever. Because remember, she gets Sonic his shoes. Where'd you get those shoes? They were too big for your own feet, kid. But I want to say this. Also unexpected. And I wish we saw more. Because he was so goddamn cute. You talk about baby Knuckles?
That's true. We got a little baby Knuckles up in there.
Baby fucking Knuckles. Dad, can I come too? No.
We're going to war.
We're going to go die. They don't say how they die. Yeah. I loved it. I mean, like, they wanted to have the two characters relate a bit to each other, and now they both lost stuff that day, and neither one of them was a part of it. It's just the way the world works.
Basically, Sonic and Knuckles' relationship is like every European post-World War II baby. Where, like, their parents, like, if like, you're, like, my parents were fighting for the Nazis, or, like, and, like, well, mine fought for the Soviet Union, it's like, oh, now we're best friends, but, like, our parents probably, like, killed each other on the battlefield. Like, that's what I thought of. I'm like, damn. Their parents war heroes.
I also found it kind of dumb. Knuckles' dad was the chief or whatever, I think he said something like that. Whatever, he was leading the charge. If Knuckles is the last of his kind, that means all of the people that were there were the last of their kind. Why would you bring them all?
Maybe they all starved. I think that Knuckles TV show might be part of that.
Speaking about Guardians of the Galaxy, Eggman sends a distress signal and plays he doesn't really play dead, but he kind of plays dead to see who comes out of the portal, and there's just people coming out. I was like expecting the Knuckles thing from the trailer of him walking through the ring that we saw. That happens after just people come out, and they look like, you know, Guardians of the Galaxy type of weirdo goons.
Actually, when kind of, and granted, like franchises, whatever, you can hate them, whatever. And MCU, I know people hate the MCU or like to hate the MCU, whatever. I get it. Maybe it's a little overdone at this point. I don't know, but it would have been kind of cool if they did have actual Guardians of the Galaxy, like Drax's kind of looking dudes come out of there or something. That would have been like, oh, is the Sonic and technically in the same universe or like in a multiverse kind of thing? I think that would have been maybe kind of funny. But
the only thing I can think of, besides maybe just doing it to be weird, is that that implies that there's people on other planets. You know what I mean? And not just anthropomorphic animals, you know? It's just an idea.
There's one other joke that I think was, once again, that for me, I feel like we live in a simulation. Or that, like, maybe my reality is the only true reality or some weird Matrix shit. That they make a joke about The Rock and Vin Diesel.
Explicitly. Yeah, that was in one of the trailers, which was a disappointment that they did that.
Was it in the trailers? I don't remember it being in the trailers. But the fact that they said that, and I'm like, what are the chances that we exist and we make a Sonic movie show, right? And we have this other like kind of side project that we've been doing for 2 years around the same time of this movie franchise. And we've been going through all the Vin Diesel movies. And we, a couple months ago, we had some beef watch, you know what I mean? And I'm like, and that could restart the beef. That's all I'm going to say with that. So that could restart the beef. Maybe Vin Diesel will go to the movies and see this and be like, fuck, I messed up. Or maybe The Rock will go see this. That is like, that would be way too, like, if somehow this movie convinces The Rock to come back.
Well, yeah. Here's how I see if both of them see this movie. Obviously, they would not see it together. How they would do. Vin Diesel would laugh at it. And The Rock would kind of roll his eyes like, oh, my God, type of a thing.
He'd laugh, but he'd deep down he'd mad.
Yeah, it's like, oh, my God, that's not stop making it a thing. It's he's making it the thing. You know what I mean? I'm not making it the thing. Now, here's a funny thing. Earlier this year, Rock says he's in one of the baddest video games of all time. He's been playing it for years. He's coming into a movie. What if he was in talks to be in Sonic 3? Whoever, I don't care. And he sees this, he's like, oh, fuck no, I'm not now.
Or that's revenge. Jeff Fowler wanted The Rock to be Knuckles, maybe, or something. And then he's like, fuck it. Y'all pissy over there with your dumb meathead franchises.
The Rock being Knuckles would have felt weird.
It's I'm just saying, if we're going to try to purposely start drama, I think that would have been hilarious that, like, or Jeff Fowler listens to the Chronicles of Diesel.
Heard our
plea to both of them to settle their differences and maybe
squash the beef.
And The Rock come back in the movies for the last one. One of the last Fast 10 movies, because there's going to be two. And maybe this is a way for Jeff Fowler to help us out here and help out the Fast franchise. By like trying to call out the beef a little, be like, y'all silly. That Sonic the Hedgehog roasted you. Both of you.
This guy did it. He did it. You know?
Yeah.
I would like to see The Rock in one of these movies, but I don't know who he would be.
I don't know if The Rock's gonna be in the
We already did an episode about this. Let's move on.
Well, I was gonna say Vin Diesel and The Rock are definitely not gonna be in any of these movies just because of that joke, I think.
Probably. Another character that felt like they were there just because, well, if basically everyone from the first movie is in this, got to bring him back too. Officer Wade.
Yeah.
I didn't really laugh at anything he did in this movie.
I like the butter knife.
Yeah, I guess. There was that scene, and then the scene where Sonic's having the party at home alone with the dog, with Ozzy, and there's a blackout. And then, like, the camera cuts changed, and it's like a horror movie type of camera angles and following. I'm like, there's that. And then, yeah, when you cut to him with the butter knife, and it's like serious interrogation type of stuff. Like, I like those camera angle changes, camera, like, tones, I guess.
Yeah.
Cinematography changes. But him as a character and the things and the jokes he said, didn't like it. Didn't care for it. He could have been cut too. I feel like him, the last, you know, quarter of the wedding stuff in Hawaii could have been cut. Obviously, you know, if he's not in it, then they would need to write around and make other reasons why certain things can happen there, I'm sure. But, like, I don't know, it just felt like, oh, yeah, he was funny in the first movie. What's his name? Ben Schwartz clearly loves the man. You know what I mean? So, of course, he's in the movie. But it didn't really feel like he did anything, and I don't know.
Yeah, I generally agree. I mean, I thought he was fine. I don't think he was, like, awful or bad or anything, but, like, how much he served a purpose, yeah, it's kind of hard to gauge, because at the end anyways Eggman just comes back, but maybe it was a way for him to show off his new powers, but like at a level that isn't just from 0 to 100. Like, okay, he teleports, he rearranges his by the way, I just love this whole coffee shop in general. Like, I just love that's like basically a, like just like a gaming room like vibes it gives me. Yeah, like maybe they could have done that.
Yeah, and then when Eggman comes back with the Master Emerald inside him and he's all green, all of a sudden the lights in there are green now too, and it looks like a Razer product. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Laser gaming.
One thing we were right in the prediction was that we guessed that the Bean Coffee Shop would be in Green Hills, and it was, and like no one
noticed. There's no reason, though.
I just love that it is, though. Like, I just love that, like, no one called them. Like, Tom's been working, like, since then, I'm assuming. And, like, you know, like, you're like, bro, I've literally seen you before.
Yeah.
Working with Eggman. Like, and I like that they just don't acknowledge that, though. I think that is funny in itself.
Not even, like, a hint as to, oh, yeah, it's in Green Hills. I will say it implies that there's a couple things. Obviously, they wanted to make Eggman not have the, you know, first movie, Eggman is a G-man type of, he's funded by the government. Obviously, then there's a lot of red tape in what he can and cannot do. Sure. This movie's like, yeah, he has a bunch of satellites. Yeah, he has this. Yeah, he has that. Sure. He just does it because we don't want him to be, we just want him to have this stuff to do this stuff, right? So either this coffee shop in a place that they did not know would be important, and you know, in Montana, they set one up, or it means Agent Stone isn't as dumb, you know, as he could be, because he would have had to have at least installed the equipment. You know what I mean? At the very least, if it was already existing,
he had to put it together too. When he's disguised as one of the soldiers, or whatever, I think he's just very good at blending in. At least they're trying to like kind of say that he is. So I hope that like he is doing something else in Green Hills in the next movie in some way. Maybe he works at a hardware store or something. I don't know. Just like find a way to like, or maybe somehow he finds his way, like, because since he's like as a disguised a soldier, somehow he has like a really high up government job or something. Like, he's able to get files for Eggman in the future. Or maybe he's the one that
replaces the Olive Garden dude. He's just that good. He just replaces him.
Yeah, and they don't explain it at all.
What happened to the other guy?
Oh, he's retired. Or something.
Like, permanent vacation.
Yeah, permanent vacation.
And it's like, what the fuck did you do?
But maybe that, maybe when we'll do our, like I said, we'll do an episode on our predictions for a Sonic Movie 3 and whatnot. But I'll just say maybe they can use him in any way in terms of the government stuff to get to Shadow.
Yeah. Man, what more is there to say about this movie? There was a dance-off scene I was not expecting.
Yeah. Shout out to that whole, they actually could dance too, so shout out to them for doing their thing.
Yeah. Shout out to Tails and Sonic for dancing.
I'm sure you love that scene, because I know it's one of your like least favorite songs that they dance
to. Oh yeah, absolutely. I honest to God hate that song. I cannot stand that man. not really. I'm sure he's a fine dude. Yeah. The Siberia stuff almost felt like it was an unnecessary scene in there. It felt like, let's have another the bar scene, but have Tails and Sonic and just see, you know, because that's cute. You know, Tails and Sonic and their bundled up snow stuff was cute. Weird though that stuff was left outside. because clearly it belonged to people that were in the place.
I mean, it might be extra.
They would have had to walk out in their plain clothes and then put it on. But obviously, they were kid size too.
I did like how the scene did set up that Tails has cool technology, like the being able to
the holograms.
Do holograms? I thought that was neat.
Yeah, yeah,
that was a cool power that they gave Tails, if you want to call it power, but a thing.
Yeah, Tails inventing the stuff is not shown though in any stretch of the imagination, so it feels just like he just has this stuff. Obviously, we could put him at his word that says that he made it, but like it would have been cool to see him, you know, create
using a wrench or something, even just like,
yeah, using a wrench. You know, there's a hilarious piece of you know, Sonic, you know, like stories and stuff have a lore Bible. You're like, this must follow this. You know what I mean? Like, blah, 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 whatever it is. For any type of medium, you know, if there's a story, there's usually a story Bible, a lore Bible, you know. Sega has one, apparently. I was watching a video a couple months ago about the Sonic Boom Rise of Lyric game for Wii U and how much of a failure that was. And that game started off as a game called like Sonic Origins. It's supposed to be like, hey, an alternate universe type of take, but like here's how Sonic and Eggman meet type of stuff, and his friends are with him or whatever.
Yeah.
In any case, the game got changed a whole lot. Part of that development, one of the things they had was there was this crafty inventor guy, like a person that you could come and talk to, and maybe he upgraded equipment for you. I don't know. Whatever it was. Sega told them, the team, no, he can't be an inventor. Only Tails can invent things in the Sonic universe. Only Tails is allowed to invent anything for the good guys.
Society until Tails.
Not necessarily that, but like Eggman makes stuff for bad guys. Tails makes stuff for good guys. We don't want any
Tails
more characters.
Made the atom bomb because America's a good guy.
Yeah, exactly. No, Tails made a fucking tiny ass ray gun,
which is kind of cool.
Yeah.
That's purse size right there.
And also, yeah, a disappointment about that. Tails didn't make that plane. The classic Sonic, you know, 2 and 3 biplane. That's
he did add
they just
it,
bought
though.
That. Yeah, sure, but like
guns to it.
That's not his plane.
Maybe he'll get one.
This
guy, Sonic
Games, that was his plane.
Maybe he'll get one. He got to wait. He's got to work for it, all right?
Yeah. He's got to, yeah,
he's got to work a 9-to-5 like everyone else to work, to save
except
up
the
for
people
that,
plane. That have all the money, they never needed to do that. right. Sonic drops all of his rings off a cliff in Siberia.
Dude.
So does he not have any more rings?
Yo, imagine like 5,000 years from now, when climate change has fucked up the earth, someone's going to find that. And like, it's just going to like, they're going to throw it one day and it's just gonna be like, fuck, we can go anywhere.
I wish I was somewhere that wasn't fucked and it takes him to like another planet and it's like
perfectly,
yes,
fine. Yeah,
we begin anew. Yeah. This is just 800 years later, industrial revolution.
There you go. There's your Sonic 10 movie where it just has nothing to do with Sonic because it's about like, yeah, humans surviving.
That is your third sequel series to Agents of Gun.
There's some rings we found, sir, in Siberia. Yeah. And it's, yeah, in the wrong hands. Yeah, that's such
a
Agents of Gun. I want that now.
Now, the gun logo is different than how it's presented in the games, but I think that's fine. Guardians of United Nations, I think is what they said. Something. I don't remember what gun stand stood for in the games, but it was something also similar.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Fucking gun.
Let's see, any other fun parts of note? I liked the Rube Goldberg machine of mushrooms at the beginning. I like that,
that
he's,
I don't
just
know if that was
likes
animation
coffee
or like some weird stop motion stuff, but it looked really good, like the little Sonic,
I think those
running
were legit props.
It looked really good. I feel like they, yeah, were trying hard at the beginning. They're like, yo, we came to play, we came to,
yeah,
play.
Yeah, it felt like that. I think those were real props that were just assisted with animation
because it looked, yeah, really good.
Yeah.
Now we know when, at what part, too, that Jeff Fowler did the, that one meme that we turned, that one picture,
oh, yeah,
of him with the clapper there that we turned into our logo.
Yeah, yeah, that was clearly the last thing they filmed, was that.
That was the beginning.
Beginning of the movie. Maybe we're like, hey, we have some budget left over. Let's make some weird lightsaber dudes.
I know. We have some, like, James Gunn left us some, like, cool outfits in the back. Like, can we use these? Yeah, sure, why not? Spaceman? Sure.
Yeah, we could nitpick a lot of stuff. You know, I could say how, like, I think the robbery stuff at the beginning could also be shortened down or whatever. Like, there's stuff we could say that seems minor at this point. Is there anything, like, you want to make sure we finish off before we finish off?
I one other thing I think was a little bit more. I wasn't sure how the fighting was going to look, and I thought the fighting was cool. I feel like it would, like, actually, like, look like it was painful for them to fight. Like, I wasn't really sure if they were just going to bounce off each other, like, in the, like, you know what I mean? So, like, yeah. I was kind of...
For, like, an anime.
Yeah, so I wasn't really sure how the fighting was going to look, even after watching the trailers. So, like, you know, I feel like they did a great job of making Knuckles actually feel more powerful than Sonic, that when he punches him, it has a lot of oomph behind him. So I thought that was cool. Yeah, just, like, small stuff like that, I think that was cool to look at, and I didn't have any expectations for those things, so I was just kind of like, I don't know how they're gonna do this, and then they did, I think, a good enough job to show those things. But I'm excited to see this again and see I'm sure there's things we missed, I know we want to do more of a recap episode next, like actually go from general scene to general scene, so maybe that'll help us pick up on some things we miss. I think we covered I feel like I covered all my reactions to it.
Nice. Yeah, for me, like, I like this movie a whole lot. It's hard
has a lot of charm.
It's hard to sit here and do a review like this and not just start at the baseline of I loved it. Here are other things then, you know, the criticisms of things that I didn't like without, but I don't want to stress that, like, you know, I did really like this movie. I like the animations. I like the characterizations of our three main anamorphic animal characters. I thought it was a very fun time, and, you know, the whole structure of the story felt like it went pretty decently along, and I was satisfied with everything I saw for the most part. So I guess now final question for you, Devin. What would you rate this out of 10? Do we do this? Not really, but, like, what if you were to give this a rating out of 10? Well,
earlier I think you said, like, a 9 out of 10 for, like, a kid's movie, and I would agree with that. I think in terms of, like, if I have to just throw a number on there compared to every other movie I've ever seen, for me it's, like, if the first Sonic movie for me was probably, like, a 7, I mean, it doesn't mean it's bad or anything, but just, like, you know, it's fine.
That's That's fair.
Yeah. I would probably say this was, like, a 7.5 and 8. Like, I don't think we're at a 9 or 10 yet. I think they have the ability to, and I think we can get there. And Jeff Fowler is still, I think, this was his second directing movie, so he's going to learn things. He's going to get better, I think. True. Some of the writers, I know this is kind of their first big projects as well, so they're only going to get better. I think they really, like, as long as they're going up, I think that's, you know, all that we can ask for. I think our expectations were fair going into this, and I feel like they hit those, generally speaking. There's some things I was disappointed in, like we mentioned, but there's a lot of things that were unexpected, and I'm happy that they're unexpected because it made the disappointing things feel less disappointing. I would say like a 7.5 and 8, and I, you know, definitely probably one of my favorite video game movies. I'll see it again the second time, and maybe it'll maybe be my favorite by the end of it. Who knows?
Yeah, I'm kind of with you there. I feel like they can easily do better. I would say just one final thing of note, you know, in terms of the Sonic versus Robotnik stuff in this movie, this is kind of what we wanted from the first movie. Like,
yes.
This is what you would expect if we said, oh, yeah, they're going to make a Sonic movie. This is what we would hope for the first Sonic movie. So there's plenty of places they can go next. You can follow the show on Twitter at Sonic Movie Show. We did a whole bunch of tweets about this movie. Check it out. We're also on TikTok at the same handle. I'm on Twitter at Ethan Absolutely, and Devin is on Twitter at Kersona Fun. Check out our other episodes. We had an episode titled Sonic is the Blue Chaos Emerald that is now hilariously incorrect, but it was a fun idea. We also did an episode where we casted every single main Sonic game character with a Hollywood actor, which was also very fun. And we'll see you next time for another episode, most likely about this movie, on the Sonic Movie Show. Bye-bye.
Have a good one. Sonic